Hello.
Simon Young.
How are you?
I'm all right, mate. I was trying to remember the last time we actually had a real life conversation, either in person or over the phone. And I'm going to say the last, obviously, we've been speaking over the wonderful means of social media, but I don't think we've had a proper chat, dude, since December 2016.
Was that at a Christmas party at the Big Red?
It wouldn't have been at the Christmas party, but it would have been right before Team Rock closed.
Ah, right, yeah.
Because I haven't spoken to you since that. I haven't spoken to you properly about any of that madness, and I'm sure we'll get into that later on. But obviously, this is something that me and you used to do going back 10 years now. When I was on Kerrang Radio, when you were at Kerrang Magazine, every week,
yeah,
I'd call you up and we'd have like the lowdown of what's going on in the magazine, what you've been up to. And yeah, man, a lot of good memories have come flooding back in the lead up to this chat, and I'm excited to talk to you, dude.
Yeah, it was like Tuesday afternoons. I'd dive into an empty office and just talk at you on the phone.
Well, my favorite story that you told me was when you'd been out to Austin for South by Southwest, and it was the year that Fat Mike had like debuted his Cokey the Clown character, and he'd allegedly or seemingly urinated in a bottle of Patron tequila and then come out and given shots that were supposed to be from that bottle to the crowd, and then he performed in that character and, you know, told all those dark stories, and you were there, weren't you?
I wasn't actually there, but I'd somehow convinced Fat Mike to do a fairly long Q&A for the mag right afterwards, and he was playfully being a bit cagey about the contents of the glass, but I don't think he would. It was probably very weak Schlur or supermarket owned apple juice watered down, because it does have the same consistency and color
of your own.
I wouldn't have drank it.
No, well, I've seen there was another video that he did, which they revealed later on. He talks about it in the book as well. They did like a last minute switcheroo. But what he did say in the book, that he left the bottle that he actually pissed in the dressing room, and then when he came back, one of the other bands or whoever had nicked it and taken it. So he's like, the crowd didn't drink my piss, but somewhere somebody did. Well, the moral of that story is, don't go nicking people's tequila.
That's it. Bands are very precious about their riders, so a lesson to be learned there.
So what's been happening, dude? I guess, first of all, before we get into you and your journey and your story, tell me about how lockdown life has been for you as a husband, as a father, as a freelance writer, as a human. How have you found the last 6 months, mate?
It's been all right. It's just the trips to the supermarkets have been really unsettling. Because I kind of live in the house and rarely leave other than school runs anyway. And I was kind of, I'd say all my friends, well, I'm working from home now. And I'm like, yeah, good luck.
Welcome to the club.
Yeah. And because I was writing the book we're going to speak about soon. So I was kind of every night for about 3 months working on the book. And I was working towards this kind of March 31st deadline. I thought, as soon as I've got the book done, I'm going to go to the pub and have a few pints and celebrate. And a week before that, Boris Johnson comes on the telly and says, we can't go out now forever. And yeah. It's been very strange. And, kind of anxiety and dread comes in waves. But generally, it's been okay on a personal level within our small family unit. Just watching the news every day, it just seems like a really weird Charlie Brooker kind of story unfolding. And it doesn't seem to be slowing down or showing any signs of getting better, really. So I've just resigned myself to never going out again, really.
this is your new normal.
Yeah, pretty much. How's it been for you?
Oh, mate, it's been hard, man. Yeah, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. For me, I think because I'm, very much entrenched in hospitality and live events through the various different roles that I carry out, be that as a DJ or, touring and hosting live Q&As and everything that I do, not just professionally, but really personally, is centered around, you know, gathering places. You know, I'm not in a relationship, I'm not a father. So for me, my life is really centered around out and about social activities with friends and, you know, the sort of families that I've made over the years of doing shows all over the country. And to have that all ripped away, as well as the money and the income, it's like the double whammy. And it's been really hard adjusting. I mean, thankfully, I've had my book to work on as well. So that's kept me nice and busy. And there's obviously still an element of productivity and positivity. But on the whole, it's been like one of the most, if not the most challenging years of my life, for sure. Okay. And as you say, it's like, you know, initially I thought it will be a few months and then, you know, things will resume and I can ride this out. Perhaps by the end of summer, we'll be back and rocking once again. But I mean, now I've kind of resigned to the fact that even this time next year, it's not 100% certain that, you know, shows and festivals and pubs and everything else will be back to the way they once were. So I guess you just, it's like adapt or die, isn't it? You have to just roll with it and crack on. So, dude, your first job in the industry, was it working for Kerrang magazine? Was that your salubrious start in the world of the music magazine, industry and journalism?
Yeah, magazine-wise. Yeah. I came to London to study film studies and communication studies at Middlesex in 94. And I picked a London. I went through clearing because I didn't apply myself in the 2 years leading up to that. But I picked a London-based seat of education purely on the fact I could go to gigs, because at the time, not many bands that I wanted to see really came to Newcastle. And I never got away with fake IDs and stuff because I was quite baby-faced at the time.
Dude, you still are. You don't age.
Well, you should see the portrait in my loft. It's rotten.
Dorian.
But yeah. But there's, I could, like, the last gig I saw in Newcastle before moving down to London was Pantera at the City Hall in Newcastle.
Wow.
And Understand supported them. And I was more into Understand. And I think that really pushed me towards the sort of more post-hardcore end of music that I listened to more or less ever since. And the power kept cutting out at the City Hall, and I got my tenor back, which was fantastic, because I was on my way to London. And during my degree, I became the music editor of the Planet magazine. It was the free student newspaper at Middlesex University, and I was the sole music writer, so I was basically, I did everything myself for that part of the mag. And Curb Dog were the first band I ever interviewed.
There you go.
And I remember sitting on the stairs of the flat I lived in, Honest Grove, and I didn't really know how to record a phoner, so I kind of gaffer-taped my Walkman, which recorded stuff, to the receiver, and I was really trying hard to hear what Cormac Battle was saying on the other end, and it was getting the faintest kind of recording out of it. So it was a big learning curve there. But it was about a year after university that I moved back to Newcastle for a few months just to try and see what I could get with a fairly useless degree. And I went back to London to work as a runner for a post-production company. And I was working a lot of night shifts, and there was nothing to do other than get the odd coffee here and there. So I started doing a fanzine, and then I bumped into Phil Alexander at Kerrang. Lots of gigs, and I eventually plucked up the courage to hand him a copy of it. And then not long afterwards, I was offered some work experience and did that and never really left.
So when you say you noticed Phil Alexander, who, for those people listening who don't know, he's like the editor-in-chief. Is that his role still now?
Yeah.
How did you know who he was? Just from his picture in Kerrang? Or
from his picture in Kerrang, and he used to present Raw Power,
right?
Which was like the if you didn't have satellite TV, it was basically the only hour of music videos you could get in the early 90s and stuff. So he was always very approachable, and I just said, oh, I've done a fanzine, and here you go. Oh, and do you remember in the Kerrang magazine used to be a little sort of on the masthead page, there'd be a little thing called stimulants, where it's like this magazine was made with the following stimulants, and it would list like stuff they'd been to and seen, and just little shout outs to things. And there was a little picture of my fanzine in one issue.
What was that called?
Called Hit the Guy with Glasses.
So have you always, you've always worn glasses then? That's always been your look?
I don't know what year they call it now, but since top infants, the year before first year junior, I wore glasses. And it was named after the Voodoo Glow Skulls song.
And what was the content of it?
It was Q&As. My friend Nick, who sadly passed away this year, he did some interviews with like Cherry Pop and Daddies. I did stuff with, I did like live reviews of like A and Rock from the Crypt and Foo Fighters. And there was...
So this is 96, 97.
It would have been a bit later than that, actually. I'm trying to think when it would have been. So of 98.
Right.
There was a huge interview with Pete from Group Dog Drill, who I adored then and still adore now. And it took up a lot of the stuff in the issue and things like that. And there was a picture of Michael Douglas from falling down on the cover. It was just a very cut and paste job done at one of my boss's desks at work, because no one was there apart from me and a few other tape ops and stuff at 3 a.m.
How many issues did you do? Was it just like a singular one-off thing, and then you got in the door at Kerrang and you're off?
Yeah, I did one print one. I think I printed about 30 copies and sold about 2 and gave the rest away. And then I had this idea to do it on the internet, which was this new cool thing happening.
Yeah.
And but then I got offered some work experience, and a few months later Ashley Bird said, oh, we need someone to file some photos for a few weeks. Do you want to? This was at Cable's last gig at Dingwalls. I bumped into him, and he said, yeah, we need someone to do some filing and stuff. Are you up for it? And I was kind of went straight to the office before I gave him an answer. And I just kind of just hung around, you know, made tea and made myself useful. And so the first issue I wrote for would have been around May or June of 99. I think it had either Chino or Serge Tankian on the cover, and I did a little column about funny websites.
It's funny, isn't it? Because when we were, obviously you started a little bit before me, but it was still the case when I started out, is, you know, you turn up, as you say, you got like a week work experience is how it starts. And then if you get on well and you work hard, you just kind of linger, don't you? And, and then there's new jobs to be doing all the time. And then the longer you stay, the more responsibilities you get, the more you learn. And then eventually, if you're good and they like you and you fit in and everything, then, you know, a position comes up and you're off. And I wonder whether it's still the same now. And I wonder, because I've noticed, I don't know whether you've noticed this as well, I've noticed that there was a lot more working class people in the music industry when we were doing our thing. And it seems like now it's so unaffordable for anybody from a less privileged background to be in London and working for free, that it seems like that door is shut to a lot of people from a certain background. I don't know whether you've ever thought about that or noticed that, but I do seem to see like the younger people that are starting out in the industry have clearly got a bit more of a, you know, a bank balance rolling them from the family, which is obviously a great position to be in if you're in it.
Yeah, I've often wondered how, like, especially now, people who do like internships and stuff survive, especially in London, because even with, you know, a proper salary and stuff, it was hard enough.
Yeah.
At the time I was doing odd shifts at the local pub and things, and just hustling, you know, see what I could do to just make money. But when I started again in the June, I started doing the letters page and just bits and pieces, and was kind of just given like a weekly wage. And I went to literally every gig I could possibly go to. It didn't matter who it was. I was just so taken with the idea you could go into a gig for free and get CDs for free.
I know, man.
I loved every second of it.
Who did you see around that time live, you know, around 99, 2000? Because music at that point was so exciting. And probably the last time when guitar music was dominant in the pop charts, wasn't it? You know, whether it was bands like Foo Fighters or Queens of the Stone Age, or you obviously had the new metal stuff, you had Blink 182 and Offspring and that stuff. For me, that seemed like the last hurrah for guitar music, and obviously you had so many incredible bands just coming up and starting out as well. Do any spring to mind, like iconic shows around London from the turn of the millennium?
I remember Red Hot Chili Peppers played at Coco, and I'm sure I just started some. It was like a summer gig, and I was like there, and I was, because I grew up listening to Chili Peppers. I was like, I can't believe I'm in such a tiny venue for this.
I know, man. And this, is, like, Californication era as well, is it?
Yeah, it would have been. Because I remember the tickets with that kind of star logo, and it had the kind of fiery colored clouds on it. So it must have been then. Yeah, it was definitely John Frusciante. And it was right until the last minute that I was finding out whether they had a spare ticket to go. And I was just like, wow, I got in here for free. And after that, around the awards, they would have like small club shows at this pub called the Falcon in Camden, and Rich from Black Halos posted some photos recently where they'd played with Murder City Devils and stuff. And
Rich Jones.
I can't remember. Yeah, and I can't remember going, but I'm adamant I was there, because if it was a Kerrang evening, I would have gone, and especially with like bands like Black Halos and Murder City Devils, because that's the kind of rock I was pretty much exclusively listening to at the time. And it just brought back memories of seeing bands like Will Haven, and who were amazing. It's just the back room of a pub.
Yeah,
and then
you'd have
people like Derek from Sepultura hanging out, because it would be like the days leading up to the Kerrang Awards. So everybody was in town and everyone was just hanging out. And it was just like, I didn't know what to do with myself. It was just such an amazing start to what became quite a long career.
Well, there's a moment in the book that I've been writing where Eugene from Gogol Bordello talks about a similar experience when he lands in New York. And he says it's like he went from looking at the books on his shelf to being a character inside the pages. And it's kind of like that, isn't it? You grow up with these bands on your walls, and you're looking at the sleeves of the CDs, and you're immersing yourself in this world. And then the next thing you know, you're in a pub and you're looking around, and there's all these characters there in real life, like right in front of you. And you're like, oh my God, I'm in it. It's happening. What was your first big press trip? Like when you went abroad somewhere to do a feature story, what was the first really exciting adventure that springs to mind in that regard?
I remember quite early on, I was sent to cover Iron Maiden in France, because it was the first sort of tour with Bruce since he rejoined and stuff. And I like Maiden were my first band I got into seriously. And I just, like, my mind went blank for a split second before the interview, because I was just like, I was sitting in a van with Bruce Dickinson and Steve Harris, and I was just like, oh God, there's people I've had posters on my wall since I was 12, and I'm getting to talk to them before they do a huge gig, but they were brilliant, and I got to interview them more and more over the years, and they've always been very kind and generous, but that was the, I can't believe I'm doing this type job, and I can't believe I'm being trusted to get, the cover story.
That's an exciting moment, isn't it? I've never done a cover story, and I can only imagine the excitement, the trepidation, like everything all in one. The pressure's on, isn't it? And it's how many words generally is a cover story? 6,000, 5,000?
But I think it would have been about 3,000,
right?
Ish. But then there was an all-star Q&A where people like Kerry King and Chino Marino had submitted questions to ask the band, so I had to do that as part of the feature. But for a bit of background flavor, Bruce Dickinson was flying this, it was an 8-seater Cessna, which they called the Bruce Goose, and he would fly, it was either all of the band or the majority of the band plus their manager Rod over the channel and stuff to these gigs. But I got to fly with them from France to, I'm not sure if it was Belgium or maybe in Holland. And it was only a short jump, but that was really surreal. And I'd have like Nico McBrain was doing this kind of blog, you know, which is quite, you know, early on for 2000 and stuff. It was
ahead
of the curve. And he just said, oh, do you want to read that and tell me if you, you know, tell me if there's any spelling mistakes and stuff. And it was, that was just weird.
just helping him edit. Love it.
Yeah. And I was like, this is surreal. And, you know, if I said to my friends what had just happened that weekend, no one would believe me. But luckily, there's a few photographs floating around. Just talking about it now, it just makes me realize how incredibly lucky I was to get those kind of jobs to begin with. You know,
how many years were you there, dude? You were there a long time, right? Like, was it almost 20 years?
So it was 2014. So it was a good 14 years. Then I left to do produce the rock show with Dan Carter at Radio 1.
Yep.
And then a year later, I joined Team Rock for a couple of years. And then that ended disastrously. Then Kerrang graciously took me back under their wing. And I've sort of been a freelancer ever since.
And you still do the odd bit for them now, yeah?
Yeah. I've been doing a lot of online stuff for them. Just since COVID, they've kind of postponed production of the magazine and just concentrate on digital until it's kind of blown over.
And we'll see when that is.
Yeah, but they're still doing like, online. They're kind of doing like cover features and stuff. Like there's a big read every Wednesday and stuff. So it's, you know, it's business as usual. It's just in a different format. And what they've been doing recently is really cool.
What were the Kerrang offices like back in the day? Tell me about some back in the day. What shenanigans on a typical afternoon or night, perhaps, or morning even? You know, because that was a time when, you know, hedonism was still rife in not just the music industry with the bands, but with, you know, the pluggers, the publicists. Certainly there was a little bit of that at Kerrang Radio, not a lot, because everybody there was kind of like a little bit older and more sensible by the time I joined. But I know the magazine, and there's a few journalists that spring to mind. You don't have to necessarily name any, but I gather that there was quite a, you know, an appetite for alcohol and various other things at that time with a few of the people working there. Was it kind of like a pretty fucking rock and roll space day to day? Obviously you're getting the work done as well, but what was going on?
In the office, it was very much heads down, you know, because of the pressure of hitting deadlines and stuff. But, you know, when you went out, you know, there was always beers on the go and stuff like that. But, you know, this, it was so long ago, after 6 o'clock, people would be like smoking cigarettes out of the window, you know, obviously flying in the face of building rules. But, but yeah, it was like, it was a very fun place to work, but it was very serious at the same time. And if you had to get the work done, and but you know, there was, I can't remember any kind of Hunter S. Thompson kind of shenanigans, but you know, I was very green and naive. So
what about bands coming in? Were there any bands that were out of their minds? Did you see any eccentric behavior from musicians that were paying the offices a visit?
I missed the Wild Hearts by, ooh, I don't know, it must have been about 8 years or something when they came to voice their
grievances,
dismay over a news story and trash the office. So we never had that. I remember feeling quite weirded out by David Draiman wanted to. He was really annoyed about something I'd written in a feature. Because he was like, he had been drinking vodka and he was trying to smash a bottle of vodka in a backstage, in a dressing room. And like, they were supporting Manson, and he was trying to smash, just for fun, smash a very heavy, like absolute vodka kind of bottle. And I just mentioned that he was in a, like an alcohol stupor.
Yeah.
And he's trying and failing to smash this bottle and he could not. And he's wearing the biggest boots you'd ever seen. So I'd poked fun at that, and it was backstage at possibly Milton Keynes at an Ozfest, and he had a word beforehand, and then I was asked to go and get some more quotes from him for something else, and I was like, I can't do it, he's put the shits right up me, because he's, you know, it's quite, you know, I look 12, and when there's adults around, I feel quite young. And I was like, I can't do that. So Ian Winwood graciously stepped in, and I got the quotes for me. But, you know, because you hear a lot about journalists, you know, having real run-ins with people they've written about, but it's never really happened with me, because I was never that kind of writer.
Yeah.
To wind people up. You know, Ian Winwood, who...
Ian Winwood's your guy, isn't he?
A boxing match by Chad Kroger. None of that ever happened to me. I was more like the one who would just write daft stuff and do the more fun kind of features in the magazine, and leave the serious stuff to Paul Branigan and Tom Bryant and Ian Winwood, that kind of stuff.
What about the Kerrang Awards? That must have seen some shenanigans over the years. I only got to go really to one or two. I remember one year I got to present Jared Leto in 30 Seconds to Mars with the Best Single Award. But even then, this was 2011, I think. Even then, it was starting to get a bit tamer, I could sort of sense. But, you know, I imagine in those early years of the noughties, there was probably still a bit of rock and roll hedonism going on, right?
Oh, it was messy. I remember that the first one was, I'm trying to remember how far into it when, was it Britt Eklund broke her ankle? I think it was Britt Eklund. She slipped on some fruit that a band had thrown towards the stage, and she fell over and done a leg in, and like Slipknot were there, and I'm sure they set fire to a table. They were doing all the most Slipknot things you could imagine during the ceremony. And then I interviewed Clown backstage because they'd won something. I think this was around Iowa, perhaps. But it was when Clown had that kind of bald clown mask on. And I was leaning really close to him, because he's like, to hear Clown speak with a mask on, it's quite intimidating, I think.
Yeah, he's a foreboding dude.
And I was leaning close to him and getting the coat, and like someone went past me and went, oh, you weren't scared of him, you were really close to him when he was like shouting, basically. I was like, I was trying to catch what he was saying because it was quite muffled. but the early awards, like from what I remember, a few of the earlier ones, I cannot remember the name of the hotel, but it would be the ones where a lot of bands would stay. And
Kay West?
No, it was
Columbia?
Yes.
Yeah,
that's it. And it just piling in, and everyone just taking the mic out of the, not out of the bar staff, but just people clearly weren't staying in the hotel and were just there to carry on drinking.
And you've got, you know, one night porter on their own, like, fucking hell.
yeah, pretty much. And just looking crestfallen when you'd see about 30 hairy metalers just pile in, who've clearly been drinking since the afternoon and still thirsty for some reason. So, but yeah, they were brilliant.
Good days, man. This is pre-smartphones as well, so you didn't have people, I guess, punishing all the bands for photos. They weren't concerned about their antics being filmed. So I think people were they were a lot more free, weren't they? And they didn't, it was a bit more reckless and careless. And I miss those days, man. I miss those days of just pure raw hedonism. But I guess, you know, the world is progressing, isn't it? And civilizing. And we have to just accept that and go along with it. I want to ask you a couple more Kerrang bits before we move forward, sure, mate. Do any major mishaps or nightmare scenarios spring to mind where shit just went wrong? You know, where the feature was the hardest, most stressful experience to get done? Perhaps you lost the recording, or just, you know, whatever series of events went down. Are there any major journalist nightmares that you could share to reassure everybody out there that it happens to the best of us?
There was a really so I went out to Spain with Scarlet Page to do Deftones for a cover feature, and there was this up and coming band called Linkin Park on the bill, and they got like a 2-pager out of it. And then Priest, I think it was like after the because that tour wound its way around to, like, I'm sure it's like the London Arena in the Docklands area, and they were cover stars, obviously. So I went back. This was around 9/11. Yeah, me and Paul Harris covered Linkin Park on that tour, and they went from like London to Manchester, and it just, the atmosphere is really weird, obviously, because, you know, it's such a world-changing event, and no one really knew what to do, or, you know, it's just a lot of uncertainty and stuff. And I don't know, it just knocked me off my stride, and I just could, like, I must have written that cover feature a few times, and it was probably awful each time. There's just certain times when you just can't get your act together, and yeah. I just remember thinking, I don't know if I'm ever going to get any more work after this, because it was such a big job, and I just messed it up, and I don't know why. I just lost my mojo. But after that, I kind of righted myself. But I did wonder if that was the last piece of work I'd ever do for Crank, because it was, I just could not get the tone right for some reason.
Yeah, there's stress that is involved with writing, I think. Like, you know, if it's a simple review or a list or a countdown or feature, something like that, then, you know, you can kind of knock that out fairly easily. But sometimes when you're trying to, if you're a real journalist and you're really trying to capture the heart of the piece, as you say, sometimes life can be distracting. You're perhaps just not in your creative zone. And then added to that, the fact that this is like a major, well, it's the cover story. It's the most important thing in the whole magazine. And you're like, and a lot of travel is often involved, which often obviously involves little sleep. And so you couple all of that lack of sleep and stress, and it's high pressure shit, isn't it? I don't think people sometimes really acknowledge that. And I think people can sometimes take for granted that, because the pay as well, you know, it's not like we're rolling in luxury, is it, in this line of work?
Yeah, so. Or freebies at the moment, if any PRs would like to send any records my way.
Mate, I can't remember the last time I got a record. Literally. In fact, I tell you, the last gift that I got was your book.
Ah, there you go. You're welcome.
I'm at I would say chapter. They're not really chapters, are they? But you go through. Well, let's just jump in on the book now. So your new book is going to be out. By the time this chat comes out, the book will be here. I think if not now, then in like a week or so. What's the official release date for the book, my friend?
22nd of September. It's called So Much for the 30-Year Plan. And it's Therapy's official biography. With full support and input from the band and several key players around the band sort of circle.
And there's basically 30 chapters, isn't there? You go through year by year and just really detail in great detail the recording processes, the tour stories, creatively where the band was at. And, you know, it's not just the main three guys that are obviously now in the band. You've got past members in there as well. You've got producers, you've got friends of the bands. I know, I've known you 10 years now, Simon, and I guess for you, Therapy are like what NOFX are to me. They've always been my favorite band. As long as I've known you, you've always been going on about how much you love Therapy. So this must have been the dream project for you. Did you approach them? Did they approach you? How did the concept come about as well to do like the full retrospective? Because in the book, it seems to imply that initially the idea was going to be to do like something around the Troublegum era, right? But then to mark the anniversary, it's taken on, you know, the full retrospective approach. So did you approach the band? Did they approach you? How did it come about?
Well, the initial idea would have taken a lot less time and effort. I've been interviewing Andy and Michael at least for various Kerrang features and news things and podcasts since I started, really. Because I think they had released So Much for the 10-Year Plan, which is like a compilation in, it must have been 2000. Yeah, it would have been 2000. So I've kind of done lots of stuff with them over the years. And I was getting to that point in every freelance music journalist life where they're thinking, I should be writing a book now. I wonder what I could do. Yeah. And I just bought, there's the book series called 33 and a Third, where it's like in-depth looks at like specific albums and bands' back catalogs. And it was like the Fugazi one on the Killtaker. And I looked through their list of previous releases and there was no mention of Therapy. And I sent a text to Andy just saying, if I was to pitch for a book and maybe do like Troublegum, would you be up for doing interviews and stuff, you know, to to give the story more depth and gravitas, and they were all for it. And a little while later, he just said, do you want to meet up and talk about doing like a full biography to come out for like around late 2020? And I just met up with them and just went through everything, what we could do, and they were on board, and I just somehow managed to get Tom at Jawbone Press to agree to publish the book, and then I was off.
So you hustled the publishing deal as well?
I had to. It was out of necessity, because I thought about maybe doing like a crowdfunded thing. There's some places that do like it's like crowdfunding, but it's in conjunction with a publisher, and then once you reach your goal and stuff, then it's game on. But I just thought I'd liked a lot of the books that Jawbone had put out. They'd done stuff like with King's X, which is a really good kind of oral history of their career, and I used that as an example when I went to see Andy and Neil in London. Michael was in Belfast at the time, but they relayed all the chat back to him, and they said, it sounds interesting, can you do us a sample chapter? And I wrote about Infernal Love, because I thought that's got a bit of everything that you'd probably want to read in a rock biography. And they said, great. But they said, if you want it out in September next year, you're going to have to get in for March. So I had to just really buckle down and just write, as not quickly, but methodically and
efficiently,
with as much focus I could without any pandemics looming on the background.
Well, I take my hat off to you, mate, because having just written one myself as well, you obviously have a wife and a child as well. And I can't imagine how you balanced all of that time, because when I was writing mine, I wrote mine in a really fast space of time because I was really up against the deadline. But I basically just woke up at 9 a.m. and, wrote till like 10 p.m. and then went to bed and repeated that. And I didn't have anything at all. Someone's get rid of them. And so the fact that you've done this as a family man is an incredible testament to your work drive, but then also your ability to manage time and
there was
multitask.
But I had a very understanding and patient wife as well. So she was brilliant during the whole process, because it literally was. I did all my interviews late October until early December, and there must have been about 50 plus hours of stuff. And then I there was the transcription, and I had to like work out how it was going to flow. Like, it was going to obviously flow chronologically, but there had to be a certain kind of way of doing each chapter, so it wasn't the same thing over and over again.
How did you interview the guys? Did you interview them chronologically? Did you start at the beginning and work your way through by year with the individuals? Is that how you approach the interviews? Or
I did it a bit. There's a lot of jumping backwards and forwards. I just thought, I've got a few hours today. I know a fair bit about this era anyway, so let's just get that done, then I can work on it. So I didn't start with like them forming in Northern Ireland and finishing, at Abbey Road Studios. It was like, I think I went in, because the publisher was like, could we have a sample chapter? I thought, right, Infernal Love, I know lots about that album without even researching it, because I'd read so much when it was released, and that's when I first met the band. So there was just a lot of dipping into areas which I knew about, then just kind of filling in the blanks towards the end. So there's a lot of Skype and FaceTime chats with Andy and Michael, and then towards the end of the story, it's like from sort of after the year 2000 and stuff, when Neil joined around 2002, then I would include him in the way I was interviewing and stuff, and I would just plug the gaps, then chase up certain band members or crew members or record label people, and just kind of give the just add a bit of variety to the story, and it was good. There's a few band, like musicians and stuff, said they were up for doing it, but circumstances just meant I couldn't get it done in time, or they couldn't do it. And, but I finished just in time. So I think if I'd added to any more, I would have missed my deadline. And let myself down as well as everyone else.
We couldn't have had that. And with when it comes to working with a band on a project like this, you've obviously hit the jackpot with a group like Therapy, who are so nice and friendly and forthcoming. And obviously, with all the other outside peripheral characters, assumedly you knew most of these people just from all your years in the music industry as well. So it's fairly easy putting all the dots together and getting access to everybody that was, around at that time, not in the band, but around.
Yeah, as far as first books go, like the fact that I know a lot of people in their circle and people connected to them, and it was pretty straightforward. And I was really lucky that the band have been very good at archiving all their gigs and releases, and there was any detail I needed, I would give Michael a shout, because he's kind of archived so much stuff that it just made my job much easier. And I was given like documents that had lists of gigs from like day one, and it just made everything plain sailing, really.
Assumedly they're stoked with it as well. That would be the worst feeling in the world, right? As you go, here's the book, guys, and they go, oh.
they've been really supportive. I'd send like rough drafts of chapters and stuff just to double check that the way I'd told their story was correct and stuff, and they'd come back with great stuff, or could you add a little bit about this, and it was a lot of collaboration going on, but I was just really lucky to have their support right the way through it, because I don't think I could have done the book just typing away for 3 months and sending it off, because I don't think I'd be able to bear the tension of waiting for it to come back with a that's great, or can you redo it, please?
Oh mate, I can't imagine. Yeah, it'd be crushing, wouldn't it? Just like every minute that they're not replying, you're just like, why haven't they replied yet? They must hate it. I want to ask you a few questions as a lifelong Therapy fan.
Yes,
your favorite periods of the band record wise which ones for you stand out as their pinnacle achievements and releases?
Purely because it was my, and because I got into them not quite late, but it was like I came in on their second major label release. I remember doing work experience at Weir FM when I was in senior school, and was it senior school? No, it was maybe first year of college, and I remember seeing a Pleasure Death poster in the room where all the DJs have their desks and do all their admin and stuff. And I was like, that's interesting. But I never got to hear it because the internet really wasn't a thing. And, when you're 17 or whatever, you can't just go out and buy records on a whim. Each purchase has really got to count. But I'd stored it in my head. So I got into them in the year before Trouble Gum came out, because I bought the Short Shock EP, which had Scream Major on. And then, so Trouble Gum, obviously, is a faultless album. It's a classic, and I loved Infernal Love after that.
Loved it at the time, because obviously there's the famous stories around that album that a lot of people at the time seemingly were like, "What the hell's this? This is a bit of a left field turn." And then obviously over the years, it's been reappraised a bit more, and celebrated for the interesting album that it is.
I loved that album when it came out. I remember playing it to death. It was during, so I queued up to get it and get it signed on the day of release at the Virgin Megastore on Oxford Street, which would have been June 95.
I love it. What a full circle moment then, to go back to that show him the book.
Yeah, I mean, there's a, on, I've got a photograph with me and Michael at the time, and I'd every now and then I'll just send them and just say it was like when Alan Partridge has that stalker called Jed who gets his face tattooed on his stomach, and I said, that's the next thing I'm going to do is get your face tattooed on me. But yeah, that because I know a lot of people like not really sure of the new musical direction, but I was so into it. You know, it started off with stories, and there's just all these different kind of tones, and I love David Holmes' kind of sort of ambient interludes and stuff. It was just like a really great package of just all sorts. And because I was at uni, I was kind of listening to a lot of other things other than metal and hardcore and things. So it's like it all clicked for me on a personal level. But they've just consistently put out albums I've really enjoyed, and they're always slightly different. You know, there's never any retreading of like past glories. There's always a new element to add to it, and which even up to Cleave, which is their latest studio album, and it just all makes sense, and I love it.
There's one thing that I've always noticed about Therapy as well, and Andy in particular, and that really comes across in this book, is he's such a student of all music, and he's got all these amazing reference points when he talks about his own music. And it's almost like he has this ability to step away from his own material and creations and go, well, yeah, this is our way of being like the Jesus Lizard or Rocket from the Crypt or Big Black or whoever. And he's always had this great encyclopedic knowledge of all music. And they clearly, when they're making albums, actively and consciously go, let's make this a riff like this. Let's have a drum beat like that here. And I think that's why they're always so, like, you know, there's a lot of variety in the mix, is because they're always pulling from so many different influences and feeding it through their filter, aren't they?
Yeah, and there's jazz stuff, and like I think Andy's read every book published, judging by, you know, the amount of references he's dropped in.
Yes.
During interview stuff and film, it just they all soak up as many different types of art as they can, and it kind of feeds into what they do.
Students bands, of art, aren't they? Students.
Yeah. So I think some bands, you know, you read some older bands and they're like, oh, I don't listen to new music. And you just think, well, that's apparent from the last three albums you've read. You know.
Maybe you should. Yeah. Andy's always down with what's new and what's out and what's happening. And I love that about him. There's always that enthusiasm for not just music, but new music as well. He's always on the cusp of whatever's about and coming, isn't he?
Yeah. He was like telling me about Rainbow Grave with Johnny Doom and stuff.
Yeah.
Before I even read about them. And, you know, I've kind of learned this kind of new strands of music that I hadn't really considered before. And I just found myself listening to stuff that he'd mentioned while I was working on the book.
He's wearing a Rainbow Grave t-shirt in the book, in the final photo with the three of them outside Abbey Road. I saw that. I was like, wee, there he is, Johnny Doom.
Yeah. So he's always been into, even through the years, you know, they always met, like, around Infernal Love and stuff. I remember Michael, it was either on Headbangers Ball or Rope Out, if that was out then, my years are muddled up, but they were saying, you should all listen to The Prodigy, because if you like rock, you'll love The Prodigy, because the energy's the same. It's just played in a different way. And this was just before, I think either Music for the Jilted Generation had come out, or maybe Fat the Land was the next album, but it hadn't been released yet. But, you know, when you're into a band, you know, back in the past, and you don't have the luxury of the internet to feed your curiosity, you kind of pick up on what bands mention or list in their thanks and stuff. And, you know, so The Prodigy and stuff was, they were championing them like 25 years ago.
Yeah, they've always had great bills, haven't they, as well, with who they select to support them. And they've always been different package bills as well that appeal to different ends of the Therapy fan spectrum. What I love as well about Therapy is they're no stranger. And I've had Andy on my podcast, and he shared some amazing stories on that of his, you know, his antics. And there's some choice anecdotes in here as well. Like, I love the one where he's talking about partying with Timothy Leary out in Hollywood. I love the story from the Henry Rollins tour where he has a night out with Henry and Paige Hamilton from Helmet.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're never afraid. Andy's always been very honest and upfront about his extracurricular activities, hasn't he? So it must have been nice to have worked with him in that regard as well, and have him not be like, oh, no, leave that out. We can't talk about that. It's all kind of there and in the mix, isn't it?
Yeah. He, there wasn't one moment where he said, oh, can you do some editing? It was just like, if you said it, he was like, if I say it, it's going in the book, basically. And yeah, there's so many great stories, and you know, if he, you know, he could fill his own book with just like those two anecdotes are just a tiny fraction of the stuff that we discussed. And
yeah, I bet wasn't anywhere near enough space for all of them.
Yeah, but just the invite to somehow coax Henry Rollins out to a sort of a bar in New York, and then for him to be confronted with like a vomiting person who'd a friend of the band sort of thing, and just have to be dragged out and put in a cab. It mustn't have been a very good look.
Henry Rollins of all people as well.
Yeah. But yeah, it was an honor and a thrill to like document a band I've adored for 26 years now. And it was supposed to come out just as the tour was going to start, and a global pandemic really gave an ironic sense to the title, because their 30-year plan was absolutely scuppered. But you know, fingers crossed.
I didn't even think about it like that, but yeah, you're right. Did you have a launch? Yeah, did you have a launch event planned as well? Did you have a special occasion in the diary for the release?
I think it was just a case of going out to one of the UK dates and just having a few beers and just wetting the baby's head that way. But I think because no one can really go anywhere safely, there's talk of doing some sort of Zoom type chat where fans can log in and ask them questions and stuff, and I'll maybe host it, and we'll talk about the book and things sort of around the release date. So it'll be marked in some way, but it'll have less of a hangover the following day, probably.
Yeah, I saw Winwood hosted a Q&A the other night with Bad Religion to celebrate the release of their book, and he did a great job, and it worked really well. And because I'm obviously trying to think of stuff that I can do for my book as well, because I was going to be planning a fucking launch party at the Viper Room in LA. I was all set for a proper rock and roll book launch, and once again, you know, COVID strikes. So I thought, oh, I'll tune in and check this out and see how they work. And yeah, Ian did a great job, and it worked really well. And it would be a bit easier for you, because Bad Religion, there was about eight guys on the screen, you know, whereas it would just be you and the three from Therapy. So it'd be nice and manageable.
Yeah.
And obviously, yeah, it'd be great to get the fans involved as well and get some questions from them. Dude, congratulations on the book, mate. I really enjoyed it. And I'm really happy for you, as, you know, a lifelong writer and fan of this band, that you finally married the two in the ultimate form. And I'm sure this is going to be the first of many more books from you. Now you've got the taste.
I'm looking at other potential books, so I'll let you know when I do have a firm plan. But thank you for having me on the podcast. It's nice to relive those Tuesday afternoons at Endeavour House in London.
Well, the final talking point I would like to touch upon before letting you go is the Circa Now podcast. What's the deal? I've tried to listen to an episode, but it's not actually live yet, is it? It's coming soon, is what it says. So tell us about this. This is an idea for your new podcast. When's it coming? What's it going to be about? What's the crack, Simon?
Well, I'm going to. It's going to launch in September, and I think it'll probably be with Therapy to kick it off.
Makes sense. Yeah.
To celebrate the book and stuff. But because I used to do podcasts for Kerrang.
You were the original podcaster, Simon. You were the original guy. You were doing video podcasts before the Apple podcast audio thing was a thing.
I was second to the Ricky Gervais podcast for
you
months.
You were, because early
no
doors.
One else was doing. But it's just going to be I'm just chats over the phone just to, you know, get a few stories and just basically rip off the successful format that Life in the Stocks has shown.
It's got to be done, mate. It's a very simple one, isn't it? I mean, others have more of a thematical lean. With mine, I was like, it's just going to be an in-depth chat. And have you bought yourself a Rodecaster Pro? Have you got one?
No, I've got a microphone, a USB mic. It's Rode, and I've just been re-employing my radio skills to just get it all up and running. But the quality and stuff's fine. So for now, you know, while we can't go out and play, it'll do the job.
Well, I've loved using this, and I did a Zoom chat with Tommy Lee the other night, and it was a really like lovely chat. He was a really lovely, friendly, you know, just warm, generous guest. He was great to talk to. But I found with the Zoom thing, I don't know whether it was his internet connection or mine, but it was quite stop-starty, and it was a bit jolty. And it's good seeing them there, but I find, because podcasts for me is just all about the stories and the conversation,
yeah,
I've found that doing them over the phone, and actually the audio quality of the phone, I prefer to Zoom as well. Zoom has this weird kind of echoey, tinny thing going on, but I just find the phone ones work so well because you just dial people up, you jump straight in on the chat. And, you know, you're not distracted by looking at a pixelated, slowed down version of the other person on the screen. So you can just kind of get lost in the conversation and get down to business. Dude, it's been really nice catching up. It's been really nice catching up. I can't believe 4 years have flown by so quickly. What else are you doing? What else is going on? Are you just freelance writing and trying to keep busy and trying to survive the storm?
Yeah, just getting by, really. But, you know, the working from home thing I've been doing more or less since my daughter was born 5 years ago. So that bit was never an issue, you know, because I think some people have struggled with not leaving where they work, basically. And it's been fine. You know, it's scary out there, but in this house, everything's the way it used to be, really.
The safe haven.
More fraught shopping expeditions.
I guess as well, you'd kind of stopped going to gigs, hadn't you, really, because you're now down in Hastings, so it wasn't like you were going to 3 or 4 shows a week like the old days either. You'd stepped back from that.
The last gig I went to was Therapy when they played the Forum in early October.
Of course it was. It had to be.
But like right from the Crypt and Joe Box, you know, after the book, it was a dream run of London shows. You know, every month there'd be something to go into the city for, but and one by one, they just were postponed until next year. So it'll be fine. But yeah, it was just that, you know, it's just weird. It's the last gig I went to was Therapy. Then I wrote about Therapy.
And then you're going to launch a podcast with Therapy as your first guest.
Yeah, every week just Therapy.
Well, you could do a lot worse. You know, not only are they an amazing band with an extensive, varied and brilliant back catalogue, but as we've discussed, just lovely, lovely people as well. And I imagine a dream to work with. And yeah, man, I'll link up a link to the book in the episodes. Thanks again for my promo copy. It was nice to receive a gift like the old days. Yeah. Now CDs and records don't get sent. Books is the new jam. I've actually got the Bad Religion book that I've been sent. There's been a few others. So I'm now just collecting books instead of records. It's the new medium.
Books are the new music.
Reading's the new rock and roll. That's what it is. Reading has got me through lockdown, mate. I've been reading so much, more than ever before in my life, you know, to feed the inspiration for writing myself, but also just for the escape from the reality of the present situation. And I've found that books have been the saving grace. I loved yours, and I look forward to checking out your Circa Now podcast.
Thank you.
So that'll be out.
When's your book coming out?
So mine, I'll tell you about mine in more detail off the phone, but just to give you a brief overview, I had a bunch of issues with the cover, so I had to get a new cover done. And then the other side of it was the publishing house have just been stacked with COVID and trying to like readapt to everything that's been going on. Right. So they've taken a little bit longer with the proofreading as well. So originally my book was going to be out September 7th. That's definitely not the case now. The new date is November the 10th. So there's a couple more months, but it's all done. The new cover's done. It looks amazing. It's way better than the last one, which I'm really happy about. And I'm kind of hoping in my heart, you know, it probably won't happen, but I'm hoping perhaps if it is a little bit of a later release, maybe there's still the chance of going out to LA and doing something to mark the release of it. Because I need to sign all the pre-order copies anyway. So they were like, well, we can just post you the first pages of all the books. And I was like, well, I want to come out there. So we will see, mate. We'll see what happens. Obviously, America's a complete shit show for death rates and everything at the moment. It's been really bad over there. So I don't hold my breath.
Yeah.
But yeah,
isn't the election around November the 10th?
Yeah. 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 So what a time to be there. Could go one or two ways. Nice one, dude. Yeah, man. It's been a really enjoyable process, and it's been like baby steps for me because most of the book is just based on conversations from my podcast. So most of like the legwork and the hard work was really already done. It was just a case of pulling all my favorite stories out from the episodes that I chose to include, ordering them in a way which told like a new story. So it wasn't just straight transcribes of the episodes. And then I've sort of set them up into thematical chapters. So it's all the different guests talking about the same subjects and interweaving between each other with like little intros and stuff from me at the start of each chapter. So it's nice. It gives the whole conversations like a new lease of life and a new context. And I'm hoping that people who listen to the show will buy the book, but also that people who've never heard the show will come across the book from all the guests that are in it, and then hopefully discover the podcast, and the empire will continue to grow one tiny little pebble at a time.
That's how all empires start. But best of luck with it.
Cheers, bud. You're a good man, Simon, and this is really nice catching up. And I hope to see
I'll have you on mine when I get mine up and running to talk about your book next time.
Love it. Yeah, man. That'd be cool. I'd be in. Yeah, lots to talk about. Dude, I'm going to hit the road and say goodbye. Good luck. Godspeed. And I'll see you in the real world, I hope, someday very soon.
Me too. Thanks, man.
Nice one, Simon. Cheers, bud.